seated. Good morning. And welcome. If you're checking us out for the first time, or maybe the first time in a long time, it's a great time to be here. Maybe you made a New Year's resolution that you are going to go to church more regularly or something like that. Whatever the reason, we're happy that you've decided to join us, and we're delighted that you're here. We'd love to get to know you if you'd care to fill out one of the contact cards in the pew in front of you. That would be great, so we know how to contact you, and you can put that in the offering plate as it's passed. And if possible, and you have time, hang out with us in the lobby afterwards so that we get a chance to meet you in person. My name is Jim. I'm one of the many volunteers here at Trinity Church in Bolton, and you can learn more about us online at trinitybolton.org and in the bulletin that you would have gotten when you came in. Because of the holidays and the early printing of the bulletin, there was one announcement missed. So men, listen up. Got it? Men, tomorrow is Monday. It's also the first Monday of the month, and so it's first Monday for men. So please join us at 6 for a delicious meal, 7 for a speaker, and we'd love to have you come. While Sunday morning is a great time, it's not the only place that we learn to grow in our walk with Jesus, so please come and bring a friend. And also, just as a reminder, in case you didn't see it, this is also the first Sunday of the month, and normally we have a soup luncheon, but this month, it's next week. So the service will typically run about 75 minutes. We will be reciting together the Apostles' Creed, which will be projected. It's also in your bulletin. And if you are a follower of Jesus, we invite you to join us as we celebrate communion together. So, it's the first Sunday of a brand new year. Christmas presents have been opened. Some of them are broken and discarded already. But for the geeks among us, J.J. Abrams gave us a present. Star Wars, The Force Awakens. A present I and my family enjoyed. But we come together today to celebrate a very different present. The best present of all time. A present that even the most educated and learned among us can't fathom. Can't fathom the depths. We celebrate today the one. The one who from nothing other than himself created light. The very first present. And time, and galaxies, and planets, and animals, and everything. More presence than you can possibly imagine. And people. Family. And he, the forever real one, took great delight in all the presents that he had made. And he smiled and said, "It is very good." And he gave all the millions and millions of presents to family to enjoy. But the family took on themselves the only not a present in the whole universe. And when they did, to their surprise, the sparkle of all the other presents dimmed. And suddenly, the fun they were having tending the garden turned into work. And weeds and rocks and ticks appeared. And they couldn't let go of the weight of the not a present. And so, time passed. At just the right time, the very one who had created all of it allowed himself to be wrapped in the confines of time and family. Permitted himself the trauma of birth and ultimately the horrible pain and suffering of crucifixion by the very ones He had come to bring the best present of all time. But to their surprise, 3 days later, he came again in a new body, and he started a brand new thing, a thing that today we can be part of. And so today we celebrate the wondrous love that he poured out for us in becoming one of us and redeeming us. So stay tuned this morning as Pastor Eric brings us a message. What wondrous love is this?
Join me in standing for the call to worship, which is from Psalm 66 this morning. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing to the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing the praises of your name. Come and see what God has done, his awesome deeds for mankind.
Build your kingdom.
Yeah.
you alone, who took on flesh, who came to live among us, that we find our identity, we find our purpose, that we find grace and salvation. We thank you that when you came to establish a new kingdom, a kingdom that wouldn't pass away, a kingdom of love, a kingdom of truth and justice and grace. You are a great God. We praise you again for coming down to live among us, to be one of us. Please bless the rest of the service. Speak to our hearts. Open our eyes and our ears to see and to hear you. Amen. Please greet one another with the love of Christ.
I wish you could all come up here. We could just take turns. Then you could see everyone that's all around. If you're just down there, you see a little people. Up here, you see some people. But praise the Lord. Great to see you all here at church today. Well, we're going to begin just with a time of prayer, praying for this body and praying for you, praying for the new year. So let's bow before the Father as we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and your love extended to us in the past year in 2015. We thank you for how we have grown through different challenges that we faced. You have surprised us in many ways. And today we begin this first Sunday of this new year, 2016, with wonderful hope for all that is ahead of us. Thanking you for this day that you have made. Thanking you for giving us strength to be able to join this body here to worship you in spirit and in truth. Teach us how to pray, Lord, in this year. Teach us to pray simple, heartfelt prayers. Prayers that come right from the inner being of our very souls. That cry out to you with thanksgiving, and look to you for grace and for strength and for direction for our lives. Father, we pray for those that are sick, that are unable to join us for worship today. Some have pneumonia. Others are sick with other viruses or other things. Lord, bless them. Bless them in their homes, in their beds. Father, may they know your grace. May they know that we miss them. And Lord, pour out your spirit upon them in great measure. And Father, for those that are able to join us here today, speak to us. Speak to us through the preaching of your word, through your servant Eric. Speak to us as we break bread and as we take this cup of the new covenant and celebrate your death until you come again. May we not miss your Holy Spirit speaking to us individually and corporately as a body. We pray that you would prosper us in the new year, prosper us in our health, prosper us in our finances, prosper us in our family life, and in our spiritual walk with you, in our service, our ministry of service. We pray you give us much fruit. As we look at this vase of white roses on the communion table, Lord, we think of each rose that represents a person who prayed to receive Christ as Lord and Savior in the year past. As we empty out that vase today, we pray that over the course of this new year, we would see you add new numbers of people that have accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, and they would go on to maturity to bear fruit in their life. Hear us now as we pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as we give today, Ephesians 5 says this, "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." This is the time we give our sacrifices to God financially, but also we're giving our very selves as we do this. So this is not an intermission in the worship service. It's a big part of the worship service. So let's worship God, giving to him his tithes and our offerings. Would you offer up a prayer as we dedicate this offering to the Lord?
Dear Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for everything that you give to us. You are so generous to us. With this offering, we return to you just a small portion of that. Pray that it is used wisely for the support of this church here in Bolton and the surrounding area, and supporting your missionaries around the world. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Our children are dismissed for kinder church at this time.
Good morning. Good to be here. I have the privilege of reading the word today. So if you would open with me to Jeremiah 31, verses 7 through 14. That's our Old Testament reading, and it can be found on page 1225 in your pew Bible. Jeremiah 31. This is what the Lord says. Sing with joy for Jacob. Shout for the foremost of the nations. Make your praises heard and say, O Lord, save your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I will bring them from the land of the north and gather them from the ends of the earth. Among them will be the blind and the lame, expectant mothers and women in labor. A great throng will return. They will come with weeping. They will pray as I bring them back. I will lead them beside streams of water, on a level path where they will not stumble. Because I am Israel's father, and Ephraim is my firstborn son. Hear the word of the Lord, O nations. Proclaim it in distant coastlands. He who scattered Israel will gather them and will watch over his flock like a shepherd. For the Lord will ransom Jacob and redeem them from the hand of those stronger than they. They will come and shout for joy on the heights of Zion. They will rejoice in the bounty of the Lord. The grain of the new wine and the oil, the young of the flocks and herds, they will be like a well-watered garden, and they will sorrow no more. Then maidens will dance and be glad, young men and old as well. I will turn their mourning into gladness. I will give them comfort and joy instead of sorrow. I will satisfy the priests with abundance, and my people will be filled with my bounty, declares the Lord. Our New Testament reading, our gospel reading is found in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. And you can find that on page 1645 in your pew Bible. John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. To those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known. And our New Testament reading is Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 3, going through 14. And you can find that on page 1817 of your pew Bible. Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for his holy and inspired word.
Well, let's pray. Jesus, we come before you and we yield ourselves to you. We pray that you'd have your way. Lord, I pray that what you want people to hear, they would hear. Lord, that you would transform lives. Lord, my desire is to lift you up and to make you known. Lord, Holy Spirit, we pray that you would be preceding anything I have to say. And then, if need be, supersede anything I have to say. For your glory and your name's sake, we pray this. Amen. It's good to see you all. Happy New Year, Merry Christmas, all of that. Some new faces. Please, if you're new, come and sign the guest book in the foyer. Fill out a card. We'd love to touch base with you. We'd love to get to know you. That was a lot of reading. Thank you, Jean Marie, in the midst of a voice that's kind of cold coming on, it sounds like. And Ryan, it was great to hear your singing. Great to have you back with us again. Wow, amazing. As we look at these scriptures, one of the things we have to keep in mind is that these scriptures are juxtaposed with what is going on in their time. Despair, darkness. Not figurative darkness, not literal darkness, but figurative or in a sense of just being overwhelmed. And my guess is, if I asked you, have you ever been overwhelmed with life at times? My guess is most everybody would raise their hand. Or have you ever just been in darkness that just seems like you're just struggling to make sense of what's going on? My guess is, probably you would answer yes. Now, I'm going to let you in on one of my most embarrassing moments. You're sworn to secrecy, even though it's going across the internet and t- television, but you all here are sworn to secrecy. But when I was growing up and a part of youth group was a little different from me. It was me and the Vossler sisters. That was about it. In a small rural town in Vermont, me and the Vossler sisters. And I don't remember what we had done, but I was after we were at their house, around the kitchen table, just chatting, and it was time for me to go. And I left the house through the door that would eventually lead to the garage. And as I went into it, this was like a little pantry, and as I went into this room and shut the door behind me, all of a sudden it became absolutely pitch dark. There was a door somewhere on the other side, but it was absolutely pitch dark. So there I am in this pantry, pitch dark, feeling my way, jars, canned goods. I mean, I could still see a glimmer of light, which is the door I had just left from. But I didn't, it would, you know, can you put yourself there? This is embarrassing. And, you know, I don't know why, but I just stayed in there trying to find my way out. And it seemed like for an eternity. Like 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It was extended moment of time stuck in their pantry. And the worst part about it was I could still hear them in the kitchen. Now, if they had left, I could have probably snuck back in the kitchen and out the kitchen door onto the front porch. But they were still in there. And my pride has kind of got me stuck in there. My embarrassment of having to ask for help just, you know, so they all assumed I left. And then what did they hear? And there I appear back in the kitchen saying, I can't get out. It's dark in there. It's embarrassing. But why do we do that? Why in the midst of despair or darkness do we hang on to pride? Do we hang on to things that just keep us in that stuck place? But that's so often our case. We're embarrassed maybe to ask for help. We're just prideful. We don't think we need to ask for help. And yet there we are, muddling about in the darkness, trying to find our way. Is there a message of hope in the midst of despair? Is there light in the midst of darkness? As we look at the history of the Israelites, at this point, Jeremiah has been, for the 29 chapters, just really speaking harshly at them. And the issue, the predominant issue from the Exodus on, and really from the Garden of Eden on, was idolatry. Putting stuff, things, anything before God. Always idolatry. And you think about the Garden of Eden, that's what it was. Adam and Eve put themselves before God. They became idols of themselves. They wanted to be God. Idolatry is always what separates us from God's plan for us, His good and perfect plan. And so God allows them to feel the full weight of their decisions, and so now they're in exile, struggling to make sense of things, feeling the weight of another country's rule on their lives. They were in despair. Idolatry. Now, idolatry is not something that we just go out and necessarily seek. It's like Jim was saying earlier, it's this subtle thing that just kind of grabs us. These little things that distract us and we just begin to drift. You know, I think of all the years when I was a wilderness leader for Levita, and those who have been on Levita will and done a bushwhacking may understand this. When you're bushwhacking, especially along a ridge or along a hill, where you have your map and your compass, you have no trail, you're just kind of navigating with everything. Well, you have your bearing, but what happens? And, you know, I used to, as a leader, I love bushwhacking. I used to design 3 days of bushwhacking. My participants didn't always like it, but I loved it because of the lessons you could learn. But one of the things that's true that I've come to understand about bushwhacking, especially when you're going along a ridge, is when you come to an obstacle, and you will, a cliff, a downed tree, You come to something and you have to make a decision. How am I going to get around it? What I've noticed is that most people, when they make a decision about how to get around this obstacle, they always choose downhill. Gravity. It takes more work to kind of climb up the hill and around it. Downhill is a little easier. And there's a subtle drift. We're slowly, now they're off course. They're off the original course. They can run a parallel bearing. They're still off course. They're running parallel to it. They're not on the original course. And that's what idolatry does. Idolatry communicates that we don't trust God, that we don't love God, ultimately, that we love things more than the one who gave us everything. And so in the midst of that idolatry, in the midst of this subtle drift, God has allowed the Israelites to experience the consequences of their decisions. They're in exile. They're being disciplined. And yet, in the midst of their despair, Jeremiah, in the midst of blasting them for 29 chapters, Jeremiah, in these four chapters, chapters 30 through 33, gives them hope, consolation. He gives them hope. He says, remember in days of old, he says in Jeremiah 31:3, that God has promised that he's going to love us with an everlasting love. We need to cling to that. In the midst of despair, in the midst of things just not going well the way we imagine, we need to cling to this promise, this truth that God loves us with an everlasting love. He desires the best for us, which is in Him, found in Him. An everlasting love. Later on in Jeremiah 31, there's this promise of the new covenant. Things are going to be different. No longer is it going to be the law just for a group of people. Now, everyone will feel the weight of their personal choices. It becomes individual. Yes, I think there's still times when corporate sin is an issue. But here in the new covenant, it's an individual choice. The promise that God is going to do something new. Now one says this about Christmas, because I think when we think about despair and darkness, we need to understand the significance, the true significance of Christmas. He says, songs and good feelings, beautiful liturgy, nice presents, big dinners, sweet words do not make Christmas. Christmas is saying yes to something beyond all emotions and feelings. Christmas is saying yes to hope based on God's initiative, which has nothing to do with what I think or feel. Christmas is believing that salvation of the world is God's work and not mine. You see, God is doing something new, a new covenant. This is going to be God's work, not mine. As much as I want to have good intentions about being good, my intentions fail. My good intentions are never enough because I fail. I want to do good, but I don't. I don't want to do bad, but sometimes I do. My intentions fail. It's God's work. And as we look at what God is going to do, all of a sudden we come to the Christmas story, a time again where they're under captivity. They're not exiled to a foreign country. They're exiles in their own country. They're living under the dominion of Rome, wondering, when is Messiah coming? Totally overwhelmed by darkness. And yet darkness gives way to light. And so we see that the eternal Christ, the eternal God in Christ Jesus, leaves the throne room of God and takes on flesh, as it says in John 1:14. He takes on flesh and dwells among us. He tabernacles among us. His presence is now here. Jesus is going to experience humanly everything that we will ever experience. He will experience pain. He'll experience sorrow. He'll experience rejection. He'll experience grief. There's no emotion that Jesus will not know. And yet he does not sin. This eternal God who enters in, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the one who created light, the one who breathed life into man, was not recognized. I think of Jesus entering into Jerusalem and his passion. One of the things we have to always do is keep Christmas connected with Easter. We can never separate the two holidays. But as he's coming into his passion, as he's coming into the cross, as he's facing the cross, he comes to a scenic vista. If you've ever been with us on sunrise service, you know the hill in Wataquatic or Old Bay, where you get up and you can see Boston, and you look down and you see the city. And as Jesus is riding in Jerusalem, he sees the city and he's overwhelmed and he starts to weep. He starts to weep. He says, if only you knew the peace that could have been yours. But you missed it because you missed. You didn't recognize the time of God's coming to you. Jesus, the creator of the universe, comes into our world. And he wasn't recognized by everybody. He was not received by all, as it says in John 1:11. Christ is life and the light of man. He is light and the light of man. One of the other truths, besides knowing that God is going to love us with an everlasting love we need to cling to, is the promise in John 1:4-5, where it says, the light will not be overcome. We need to cling to that truth. Christ, you know, and if you're one of these people who, when you pick up a book, you want to get to the end to find out how the story ends, and then you go back to the beginning and read it, well, John already solved that for you. The light will not be overcome. Jesus is victorious. He starts with that. In the beginning was God. God, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Christ is eternal. There was never a time when Christ was not. Christ leaves the throne room of heaven, all his glory, and enters into our world, into our existence. He will not be overcome. It's kind of miraculous when you think about it. And there's an incident that took place in New York where a doctor says, if you're a believer in miracles, this is one. This would be one. And he was talking about a window washer, and his brother were washing windows in Manhattan when their lift, and it was December 7th, 2007, their lift broke, and they plunged 47 stories. And one of the brothers lived, survived. And the doctor says, if you're a believer in miracles, this would be one. No, he didn't, like, as he's falling, no plane came by and he fell on the plane, or you know, like the cartoons always have it, or the superheroes have it, their cape gets wrapped around a flagpole, or some clothing gets stuck on a flagpole and they're saved that way. No, he plunged 47 stories. And landed. And then on Christmas Day, in his hospital, he woke up and started speaking to the nurses and reached out to touch the nurse's face. And 1 month later, the doctors are saying, you know what? He's probably not going to walk again someday. If you're believers in miracles, this would be one. And yet there's a greater miracle still. In the beginning of the human race, Adam and Eve fell because of idolatry. From the sinless glory of being created in the image of God, Adam and Eve rebelled against God and fell into sin, death, and judgment. And in this terrible fall, he brought all of us with him, the whole of human race. But God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God the Son left the heights of heaven and descended to the earth to become a man. He lived a sinless life and then willingly went to the cross to die for the sins of Adam's fallen race. On the third day, he rose again, and in his resurrection, he made it possible for all to rise again and live forever. If you're a believer in miracles, that is the greatest miracle of all. The fact that God loves us. God does what man cannot do. He saves us. He gives us right to those who believe to become children of God, as it says in John 1, 12 through 13. Children of God. Do you understand what that means? If you're a child of God, as it says in Romans, you're a co-heir with Christ. If you're a co-heir with Christ, that means men, young and old, you're a prince in the kingdom if you're in Christ. If you're a co-heir with Christ, women, young and old, that means you're a princess in Christ. How does that feel? Think about that. In Christ, he has given you the right to be a child of God. You see, Christ is the fulfillment of the new covenant. So how do we respond to this hope, this light that is there? How do we respond with new life? Well, there was a doctor who was going to have heart surgery. A pastor was going to have heart surgery. So he asked his cardiologist, "Can you fix my heart?" And you know how sometimes doctors can be, "Sure." And he walks away. After the surgery, 12-hour surgery, he asked the doctor again, "In light of all the blocked arteries that I had when I checked into the hospital that you fixed now, how much blood supply do I now have?" "All you'll ever need," the surgeon replied. But when he's being discharged, his wife, the pastor's wife, asks the doctor, "What about my husband's future quality of life?" The doctor paused and said, "I fixed his heart. The quality of his life, the quality of his life is up to him." You see, God has done something new in us. He's given us life. He calls us a child of God. We are a co-heir with him. But sometimes I wonder if we really live that way. If we really live in the grip of that truth. Spurgeon said this. He said, "We should never be content to rest in the midst of the valley when the summit of Mount Tabor awaits us. I'm convinced that many believers suffer in a dungeon when they could walk on a palace roof, viewing the lush landscape in Lebanon. Wake up, believers, from your lowly condition. Throw away your laziness, sluggishness, coldness, or whatever is interfering with your pure love for Christ." What is interfering with our pure love for Christ? Most likely it's idolatry. Most likely it's pride. Most likely it's a willingness not to throw ourselves upon Christ and say, "I cannot do this. Lord, You know my heart. I am but a sinner. Have mercy on me. How do we respond? Some of us need to humble ourselves. Humble ourselves and go out of the darkness and say, there's light there. God, you are light. Humble yourselves. Let go of your pride. Whatever's keeping you from coming back to Jesus, coming into his presence. For some of you who are walking with the Lord, maybe your call is to be, in Jeremiah 31:6, to be somebody who stands in the watchtower. Someone who stands in the watchtower and is calling people, let us go to the Lord. Let us return to the Lord. Let us. That's where we want to be. We want to be with the Lord. Maybe that's who you are. Or there's folks in your workplace or folks in your schools. You're calling people, let us go to the Lord. Or maybe you're like the women or the people in worship and in praise in Jeremiah 31. In praise, cry out, Lord, save us. Maybe you know somebody in your life who needs to have an encounter with Jesus. In praise, pray, Lord, save. We're like John the Baptist, who testified, this is a light. This is a Lamb of God. This is the one you should follow. This one. Or it's like Jesus, willing to leave the comfort of heaven to be present in the world. Maybe Christ is calling you to be present in the world, to be like Jesus, to be light in the world. And maybe that's when you're standing on the sidelines of a soccer match and you're praying, how can I bring the presence of Christ here? Maybe it's in the cubicles when you leave. How can I bring the presence of Christ to the water cooler, to the Keurig, or whatever coffee maker you have in your office place, or in school? How can I bring the presence of Christ to the cafeteria, to the playground, to the basketball court, to wherever I'm? How can I bring the presence of Christ there? How can I be light there? Do we have a message of hope in the midst of what may seem like hopelessness to the world around us? Do we have that? Kumar, who was a Christian in South India, and he was upset because none of the people he had invited to come watch a Billy Graham evangelistic broadcast at his home showed up. And he knew there was still one more night in which they were going to be airing this show. And he's praying, who should I invite? So he felt compelled to invite his wife's sister's family. But the family had no phone, and they lived really far away. So he asked a neighbor of his wife's sister's family, to bring them to the phone for an urgent message. And when his brother-in-law came, he said, you've got to catch a bus and come to the city. Catch a bus and come to the city. But his brother-in-law said, I don't have any money. I'll reimburse you. You got to come. So the brother-in-law and his family, they board a bus at 4 a.m. They show up at Kumar's house at 5 p.m. It was a long way away. And an hour later, they watched My Hope telecast from Billy Graham. And afterwards, Kumar gave his testimony. He's playing a John the Baptist. He's testifying what God has done in his life. And he asked the others if they wanted to put their faith in Christ. They were looking around at each other. And his brother-in-law was distressed. And finally, the brother-in-law stands up and says, I just lost my job. The tea factory in our town has just closed. They have just asked us, they've told us, we need to be out of the factory-owned housing. And my family and I are so overwhelmed, so distressed, so out of hope, that on Christmas Eve, December 25th, we have a plan that we're just going to take our lives. That was then. But because they had heard the hope that they can have in Christ, a hope that breaks through the despair, a hope that breaks through the darkness, all of a sudden they're saying, but now that we know Jesus, we're willing to live in trust that he is going to be present with us in the days to come. So I'll ask again, do we have a message of hope in the midst of what may seem like hopelessness? Yes. But we need to live it. We need to proclaim it. We need to serve in it. And we ourselves need to find hope in it. It is Christ Jesus who is life and light. The Son of God came into our world to redeem those who respond to his voice. God is present. Emmanuel, God with us. And he calls us to be present in this world. He calls us to be his representatives, his kingdom people right here, right now. What wondrous love is this, that God would leave the throne room of glory to redeem and save. God has done what man cannot do. Let us continue to celebrate Christmas every day of our living. God with us. Let's pray. Jesus, as we prepare our hearts for receiving communion, as we celebrate the great gift of life that you've given us and your sacrifice, move us, Jesus. Move us to be people who live in the grip of your hope, who trust you, who are willing to put you first in our lives. It's your name we pray. Amen. Please rise as we sing.
Thank you.
Let's remain standing as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed, and it's in your bulletins, and let's join together in that. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Hear this scripture as we prepare to receive communion together. It's from John's Gospel, chapter 3. No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he or she has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love the darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God. We've been hearing much about light and darkness in our sermon today. We've been hearing about God's love, hearing about how we can letting go of our pride and to really humble ourselves before God. So let's bow right now and just humble ourselves before God, let go of our pride, and ask him to cleanse us from our sins and prepare us to receive Holy Communion as we celebrate the crucifixion of Christ. He died for us, shed his blood, so that we could have a relationship with God, a holy God, and be justified. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent Jesus into the world. We thank you for this time in the year that we celebrate the birth of Christ. The Word of God became flesh and dwelt among us. We thank you that you sent your Son not to condemn the world, but to save. Give us faith, not in ourselves, but faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, faith in his atoning blood, knowing that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just. You will cleanse us and purify us from all unrighteousness. So, Lord, prepare us now to receive this bread that speaks to us of your body. It was nailed to the cross. And this cup of the new covenant in your blood. And we thank you for this time of communion with you and with one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We'll be passing around some unleavened bread. I invite you to take a piece and hold it, and we'll commune together. If you would like to receive a gluten-free bread, Sally Schaefer is up there, and she'll be happy. Just wave her down, and she will serve you in the top. And I will serve anyone down here on the lower level if you would like to receive that. So go and serve. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let's drink with thanksgiving for that precious blood that was shed for us. Wendy, would you offer a prayer of thanksgiving for us?
Dear Jesus, you are the one who is faithful and true. And what wondrous love, everlasting and pure, that you would pour out your grace on us by coming again. Die for our sins, for we are yet sinners. Lord, we overflow with thanksgiving this morning for that truth in which we place our hope and faith. Trust that you will come again in that glorious day to bring your kingdom to this earth and create a new heaven and a new earth. Our hope is in you, Jesus, and with thanksgiving we go. Help us to serve with joy. In the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand as we sing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And again, there's no soup luncheon today. It'll be next week, so prepare to stay for a wonderful meal after church next week.
Truth. I love Christmas carols. I love Easter songs. They just are full of truth. As we think about how to live this week, how to live in this year, God is giving a message to John in Revelation, a letter to the Ephesians, and he's reminding him, he praises them for all the good things they're doing, but one thing he has against them, that they've forgotten their first love. Let us not forget our first love. Let us not put anything before God who made us, God who loved us, God who sacrificed himself for us. Don't forget your first love, but live in the grip of the reality of Christmas, Christ here in our midst every day. As Paul is writing the Colossians, he's talking about this mystery that's been hidden for generations, but now is evident, now is revealed. Is Christ in you, the hope of glory? Christ in you, the hope of glory. Allow Christ in you to shine in the world in which you walk every day, whether it's